Welcome to northern Egypt. We're a few miles down the beach from Alexandria. And at low tide, there is a very interesting phenomenon that happens here. And that is that there are ancient concrete blocks. Yes, concrete, that date from the time of the pharaohs that get exposed when the tide goes out. And in this episode, I'm going to be investigating how the pyramids were built, and some of those blocks in those pyramids were actually made from concrete. My name is Chris Everard, you're watching Forbidden TV, and from a very blustery and quite chilly Egypt, this is a special edition of Forbidden TV called Breaking the Mold, How the Pyramids Were Built. So this is my footage from the beach, which is about 7 miles from Alexandria, and sure enough, at low tide, there were big lumps of old concrete that were actually exposed when the waves receded. Now, I've got lots of books about Egyptology in my personal library, and not a single one of those books actually deals with the ruins which are underneath the sea. And it's well known that actually off the beach at Alexandria, there are actually ancient ruins in the water. And this suggests, of course, that they were built long, long ago, and over thousands of years, the sea level has changed. And I discovered blocks of quartz, which I thought was pretty unusual. But as you can see here, when the waves receded, there were definitely eroded blocks made from ancient concrete. And the ancient Romans knew how to make cement and make concrete, and it seems pretty obvious to me that mainstream archaeology has overlooked the fact that Egyptians also knew how to make concrete. So what I then did is I started looking for signs of cement and concrete everywhere I went in Egypt. And this is one of my photographs from Luxor. And you can clearly see that whatever was in that square orifice was obviously cemented in there, because you can see that the ancient cement is left behind. Whatever was in there, and you can see it's been oozing out at the actual bottom of this square hole. And this was the first time I thought, hey, you know, people have been overlooking what's been going on here, because the ancient Romans were all over Egypt, and we know for sure the ancient Romans knew how to make cement. But somehow every single book on Egyptology seems to ignore this, what to me now is a very obvious fact, that not only did the ancient Egyptians have cement, but they were actually molding some of these so-called sculptures. That's right, they were actually cutting into this cement while the cement was still in a kind of soft state. So I'm going to show you another photo here. This is another one of my photographs. This is from Karnak in Luxor. And, you know, this kind of orifice here, this really got me thinking, because there were elements to this texture that just looked to me as if this was concrete. This was cement that had been molded and shaped. And when you look at the inside texture here, you can see that there's kind of pulled air bubbles where an object was pressed in and then pulled out. And this is exactly what happens when you mix up your own cement. And then later that day, I was meeting friends for dinner at a little restaurant outside Luxor Temple. and I deliberately went inside Luxor Temple an hour before dinner to specifically take these close-ups of the materials that were used. And I have to say that this was the day that I became convinced that these statues, at least, you know, these particular statues, have been made out of cement. The interior of the statues are made out of just rectangular blocks of stone, and then some kind of cement has been placed over that basic structure. Now, I studied technical drawing for 7 years. I've got my own CAD-CAM system, I've designed houses, I've designed extensions to houses. I've flowed a lot of concrete in my time. I've built garages, I've converted garages, I've done loft conversions, and I studied building and construction techniques at Celtec in London. And I can tell you now, this statue is made from concrete. And the concrete is covered. What's happened is that they've got the basic structure has been made in blocks of stone, and then they've got this liquid type of cement, and they've sculpted it while it's in its soft form, like a sculptor would sculpt a car out of clay. Look at her nose. Her nose shows that the interior of the statue is hollow. If that was carved out of a solid block of granite, which is what Egyptology books tell us, you wouldn't have a great big cavity behind her nose. Not only has this statue of Tutankhamun's wife got a very obvious big cavity behind where the nose has been knocked off, but if you look at the top right-hand side of her head, there's a hole in her head. Now, I don't care whether you're Zahi Hawass or some person who writes huge numbers of books about Egyptology. What I know is that I'm trained in architectural design, and this is not solid granite. I don't care who you are, okay? I've got building experience, and that is not solid granite. Now, this is my footage from Karnak Temple in Luxor in Egypt, and this is a statue of the young King Tutankhamun. And what you can see is that there is a central core that's been made in some kind of rough sculpted kind of former, and over the top of it you've got a kind of cement that's been sculpted rather the same as a car designer would sculpt a prototype of a car in wet clay, and that's the technique which I'm seeing here. Now, it's obviously impossible to take one of these ancient sculptures and smash it to pieces to be able to see the interior, and the reason that this discovery has not been made until I came across it is, I think, because no one's going to smash an ancient statue to pieces. But funnily enough, 2 years ago, a bunch of fundamentalist crazy people did start smashing ancient sculptures to pieces, and I took a very close look at the interior structure of a lot of these ancient sculptures. Thousands of years ago, complex technology which bridged the gap between the physical world
and the spiritual world was developed in Iraq, Egypt, Mexico, and European megalithic sites such as Stonehenge. Buried deep inside sacred mounds of earth in Göbekli Tepe in Turkey, in Egypt, in Iran and Iraq, and also buried deep under the pyramids of Mexico, we have discovered statues of very strange demons. Alongside these statues are other artifacts which resemble the components of electrical circuits, such as the Jed pillar, which looks suspiciously very similar to a Tesla coil. In the ancient world, electricity was being generated using batteries filled with acid vinegar, and these devices created a flowing energy which was used by the Illuminati royal families of ancient Egypt, ancient Iraq, ancient Britain, and ancient Mexico to make psychic contact with spirits, angels, and demons. These devices in turn inspired the greatest scientists of the modern world, some of whom were members of secret societies which hosted seances in which ectoplasm and technological apparatus were used to show us images of the spirit world. All this technology was kept utterly secret. Welcome to the world of forbidden electrical psychic spiritual technology. Welcome to the world of forbidden TV. My name is Chris Everard, and I travel the world investigating psychic, spiritual, and technological secrets which the ruling elite have kept secret for thousands and thousands of years. This is Mosul Museum in Iraq. ISIS Muslims are smashing thousands of years of history by demolishing the statues of ancient Mesopotamia, because they say that these statues are possessed by the spirits of demons who are known as the jinn in ancient Islamic mysticism. When ISIS smashed the massive winged bull statues from the gates of Nurgul, a curious phenomenon was revealed. These statues are not carved from solid blocks of granite. So we took our cameras to Luxor Temple in Egypt, and we discovered that many of the statues which archaeologists have told us are carved from solid stone are actually hollow and filled with blocks of stone.
It's pretty obvious to me that the people who write books about Egyptology have never done a day's work on a building site in their lives. This is very obviously concrete. Now, the dark areas are restoration concrete, but the lighter areas are the interior of one of the statues at Luxor Temple, and I think anybody that's got any experience of mixing up cement will see that this is actually concrete. Our cameras reveal that some of the most famous ancient statues were not carved when the stone was in its natural state, but were carved when the stone was soft, like butter. This episode tips the world of archaeology upside down.
In this episode, we reveal how the ancient Egyptians made explosives and blasted millions of tons of rock into a pulverized dust. They then reconstituted this granite and limestone dust into concrete, and we reveal for the first time on film that many of the great pyramids and temples of Egypt, and even some of the most famous statues of the pharaohs, are actually made of cement. And the evidence is clear and overwhelming. When ISIS terrorists started to smash up ancient artifacts in Syria and Iraq, it soon became obvious that the huge winged bull statues were not actually carved from solid granite. The inner structure was made from blocks of stone, and the outer surface was some kind of concrete which had been made from pulverized granite. When the BBC broadcast scenes from inside Mosul Museum of ISIS smashing up ancient artifacts, many of them could be seen to have metal reinforcing rods actually inside these ancient statues. And when ISIS smashed carved heads from the walls of ancient temples, it was soon revealed that those ancient carvings were actually carved from a kind of ancient plaster of Paris, and they were supported with metal girders. In this episode, I question if these artifacts are all modern fakes, and if they are, then where on earth are the original sculptures? And if these are in fact the real ancient treasures from Iraq, then is it proof beyond all doubt that sculptors in the ancient world were carving not from solid rock, but sculpting in a soft concrete-like substance that had the look and feel of real granite and rock, but had the consistency of soft butter or soft cheese? The word granite is taken from the root word granulated. And if you can reconstitute the quartz, mica, and feldspar with some kind of binding paste, then you would have what is known as a geopolymer cement, or a fake version of stone. It would look and feel exactly like the original stone. And what ISIS have revealed is that in the ancient world, people didn't spend thousands of hours picking away and carving raw rock. They had a much better technique, and that was to carve into the stone while it was in a liquid, porridge-like state. This is actually not the first time that priceless statues have been destroyed by fundamentalist Muslims. By the time Howard Carter started his search for treasures, Egypt had already been in the grip of Islamic fundamentalists who had systematically destroyed many artifacts. In fact, until the time of Champollion and Napoleon Bonaparte, not a single Muslim scholar in Egypt knew how to read hieroglyphs. This secret knowledge and the ancient languages of the pharaohs and the techniques for carving stone had all been forgotten. Plus, one other ancient skill was also forgotten, and that is the art of making concrete. Ancient Iraq is said to be the birthplace of writing. Cuneiform tablets were made by pressing the tip of a wooden stylus into soft clay. Unfortunately, archaeologists have completely misinterpreted and ignored evidence which proves that ancient Egyptians pressed hieroglyphs just the same as Sumerians created indentations into clay, but the Egyptians were not using clay. They had perfected the art of making concrete out of rose quartz granite. They made this concrete and pressed their hieroglyph designs into the concrete before it set hard. The other amazing discovery is that explosives were used in ancient Iraq. And explosives were also used at Machu Picchu in Peru. In fact, explosives have been used for thousands of years in the Oriental world. But it is only now being recognized that the Inca in South America and the ancient Egyptians blasted rock into a fine powder and then mixed it with fly ash and other binding compounds to make ancient concrete.
On the Enigma channel, there is a much longer, more in-depth version of this show, and there are also several supplementary episodes as well where we take you deep into the history of Cusco and Machu Picchu in Peru, and we also take you deep into the history of Iraq and ancient Egypt. And what we've discovered is that in the ancient world, actual bedrock was blasted to pieces into a fine powder using explosive materials which were harvested from nature. They blasted sandstone, they blasted limestone, and they blasted granite into a fine powder. And what you can also see on the Enigma channel is the polymer ingredients used to bind this granite and limestone powder back into solid concrete, which was then used to build the pyramids and also many of the other statues and structures which we see in the ancient world.
There is a longer, more in-depth version available on the Enigma channel. The Enigma channel is like WikiLeaks, but instead of reading documents about secret subjects, you can put your feet up and watch thousands of fascinating documentary films covering subjects which have been censored and suppressed from the mainstream media for decades. The Enigma channel is a 100% independent TV network with documentaries and TV shows which are not available on YouTube, not on Netflix, and are unique to the Enigma channel. Archaeologists worldwide have assumed for hundreds of years that every stone artifact in Egypt was laboriously carved, even though it is widely known that the Egyptians had very small amounts of iron at their disposal. They did not have the materials to make chisels hard enough to carve granite. For years, Zahi Hawass of the Department of Egyptian Antiquities appeared on TV telling us the mind-boggling accurate and laser-sharp carvings in ancient Egypt were all made with crude, round pounding balls. Official Egyptology textbooks have repeated this mistake over and over again. And even still to this day, university students are told that the perfect laser flat surfaces of ancient Egyptian sarcophaguses are all made by banging round stone rocks against granite. All over the Giza Plateau, there are saw marks in blocks of paving stones. And in the Cairo Museum, there is an unfinished sarcophagus which has one huge saw cut in it. It is now time for the truth to be told. In the wake of the old Mubarak regime, and as a result of Egyptian people power, a new generation of archaeologists have been looking at these old monuments with new eyes. And the evidence is stacked against all of the outdated theories which were developed back in Victorian times when British treasure hunters rebuilt the Temple of Luxor and Karnak. We're now going to take you on a step-by-step guide to how the Egyptians made concrete. A concrete made from all the original microscopic feldspar, mica, and quartz. A concrete made from natural bedrock, which has fooled archaeologists for hundreds of years. Because under a microscope, the ancient concrete is made from exactly the same components as natural limestone and granite.
Right, now we come to absolute incontrovertible truth about the amazing range of building techniques in ancient Egypt. What we can see here in this wall is that a section was removed. This is at the Holy of Holies in Luxor. And something was removed. It could have been just the thin panel being chipped away. Somebody wanted to take, say for example, one of these figures, which you see here. Maybe there was a similar figure there. The wall that has been exposed behind is using this amazing polygonal technique. It's an amazing technique. And why is it done? It's done because the ancient Egyptians knew that from time to time there are tremors and earthquakes. And in actual fact, in Luxor, at the back of one of the sacred lakes, there's a kind of sculpture graveyard full of amazing sculptures smashed to pieces that were damaged during an earthquake that was only around 40 years ago. And this reminds me of Inca stonework, where you can see that each block has got a very, very bizarre shape. There's lots of guides. There's official guides and there's unofficial guides. I like speaking to the unofficial guides because they're usually people that have grown up next to these ancient monuments. And like so many instances in Egypt, you get a different story every time you speak to a different person. I ask them, is the wall that these panels are stuck to, is the entire wall built like this? One guide, one of the official guides with a government badge, he said no. He said, this is just filled in. I said, okay, it's been filled in. Okay, I can accept that. But look at the way it's been filled in. Why on earth has it been filled in with this Inca-type stonework with all of these bizarre angles? Why isn't it filled in just with brick? Then I asked one of the unofficial guides, a very knowledgeable man, and he said, well, You know, he thought that the whole wall was like this. And I said, well, it seems that, you know, the shape of these bricks kind of matched the border of this area. And he said, well, you know, it's just the way it is. There is a certain amount of apathy from people who live next to these ancient monuments. I mean, they're earning a living taking tourists around. And quite honestly, there needs to be a lot more research, because the tourists are missing out on this amazing detail. Now, like the Temple of Dendera, you can see that the walls are not solid. There are actual cavities. And why should you build a wall that's completely solid if you're using this polygonal Inca style building method? It doesn't matter whether you have lateral stressing from earth tremors or vertical stressing. These types of complex angles spread the stress, basically. That's why it's done. When I looked at this very clearly, I could see that this bottom part seemed to have been flowed as a liquid, as a cement or a concrete, and then these others have been placed on there. Look at the angle there. It's exactly the same as what you find in Incan stonework in Peru. Now I want to show you some more proof. Let's go to these statues here. Again, this is near the Holy of Holies in Luxor. And you can see that the interior texture is a lot rougher than the exterior. There's no surprise there, because that would have been hand finished. But I want to make this very clear to you. These statues are molds. They were made in molds. These statues, yes, they have been worked on with an expert carver, an expert sculptor, but the actual basic shape is a mold. At the very least, the heads are molds. And if we play the video, you can see, and I deliberately filmed this at night, that the statue next to him, look at that, great big cavity in the nose. Why? Because the head is hollow. And you can even see these join marks where this entire facial portion has been molded and it's been stuck on. Let's just roll this video. And I believe that the vast majority of the major portions of these statues are actually made of concrete. Here, this big piece here, this looks like what you call hardcore. It's just a large rock that's been added to give it bulk. And it seems to me, if I look at that edge, we are dealing here with a basic hewn structure. And for sure, there's a lot of work in that. I'm not saying that there's no craftsmanship. There is a huge amount of craftsmanship here, but these are not carved out of a solid block of stone as we've been led to believe. What they have been doing is they've been carving the basic form very roughly, and then using a combination of molded features such as the heads and the faces, and they've been flowing cement into molds for these base parts here. And they've used rocks very clearly. That's a rock sticking out there. And you can see that then, once the statue has been assembled, it's then covered. And this is really the expert kind of skill. It's been covered over, and you can see there, it's relatively thin covering, but it does the trick. And that hides a multitude of sins. It hides the concrete, it hides the cement, hides all the imperfections of the aggregate. And that's how they've been doing it. And again, we have relief carvings here. I believe, looking at this, is that this was screeded onto this surface, and then while it was still wet, had a very stiff consistency, like stiff porridge or wet plaster, then these hieroglyphs were pressed into it. Let's have a closer look at that head there. You can see there's a very deep hollow there, and there's a hole there in her head. You see that? Very, very obvious, very clear, not spotted, not reported in any book on Egyptology that I've ever seen. And you can also see that there's a very large difference between the outer screed, which has then been very expertly sanded down and worked on to give it this perfect finish. There's a very, very big difference between the texture, the colorization of the exterior layered, what they call the exterior matrix, and the interior aggregate. Quite possibly we're dealing here with the entire torso having been made of concrete, and it seems that this is the join line that goes across there.
Stone Age psychedelia is the most in-depth investigation into the kings and queens of the ancient world. It's a book which is far more than just about drugs in the ancient world. It proves that the richest families who ever walked the face of the planet gained their riches by dealing in opium, cocaine, hashish, and tobacco. Stone Age psychedelia proves that the psychedelic experience is at the root of all religions. Stone Age psychedelia is available exclusively with a free DVD documentary film from ChristopherEverard.com and also from ChristopherEverard.co.uk. The ancient stonemasons probably used molds too. In our experiments, we too were able to recreate Inca-style stonework and Egyptian-style stone walls just using tools and implements which we bought from Home Depot. Rose quartz granite concrete is perhaps the biggest secret that the ancient Egyptian architects ever had. The evidence shows us plainly that even the most noble of all ancient building materials, rose quartz granite, which is mined at Aswan in the south of Egypt, was actually pulverized and then molded as a cement. The proof is everywhere. The French doctor Joseph Davidetz has written two books and extensively researched cements which are made of granite and limestone. His books show that under a microscope, limestone concrete and actual limestone itself are indistinguishable. In today's world, granite is crushed using jaw crushers all over the world. And this granite powder is sold and then mixed with cement. Powdered granite is called decomposed granite, and it can be mixed with a stabilizer and binder and then molded under pressure to create kitchen worktops and sculptures. Under a microscope, this reconstituted granite looks identical to raw quarried granite. Our experiments for this program with modern concrete illustrate how the complex geometries found in Inca stone walls and also at the Sphinx Mortuary Temple on the Giza Plateau can all be easily recreated in your own garden if the material you are working is still in its soft state. Ancient concrete was not grey like modern concrete because the ancient stonemasons were making their concrete from pulverized granite and limestone. And so it looks every bit like the original rock that it was quarried from. When you mix a high quantity of pulverized granite, quartz, and sandstone into the concrete mix, we discovered that the finished product is indistinguishable from normal rock and looks exactly the same as the statues in ancient Egypt. The ancient Egyptians used hollow pipes to drill holes into their granite cement mixture before it dried hard. In fact, the Cairo Museum and the Petrie Museum in London are stuffed full of artifacts which were made from this ancient geopolymer granite cement. Granite and also schist stone and even quartz stone that was pulverized into a powder was then formed rather the same as a potter forms an object out of clay using a potter's wheel. Many of these drilled out cores, which the stonemasons discarded, are now on show at the Petrie Museum in London. Some of these cores are cone-shaped, and that's because the core was extracted when the granite cement was still soft and could be cut like soft cheese or butter. When the extracted core was set to one side, it slumped under its own weight, creating the phenomenon which we see at the Petrie Museum in London to this day. If these cores had been extracted from quarried blocks of granite, then the cores would have straight sides. But because they were extracted from squidgy, soft, pliable granite cement before it had hardened, when the discarded cores were stood up, they slumped under their own weight before hardening in the desert sun. That's why these cores do not have perfectly straight sides. Also, linear score marks inside the core holes mean only one thing, that a rod was pushed into the rock when the rock had the consistency of porridge. The rod had a notch on it, and this created the long linear grooves which we see inside holes inside blocks of stone at the Giza Plateau to this day. The use of granite and limestone concrete also explains why there are so many artifacts in Egypt which have perfect laser flat surfaces. Perfect flatness is automatically achieved when a liquid like poured concrete comes to settle. Ancient Egyptians did not need lasers or UFO technology to make flat surfaces. They made molds by hand carving soft clay formers, and then also made molds from sheets of finely sanded and oiled wood. In fact, we experimented with making our own concrete sarcophagus, and we discovered that even ordinary cardboard boxes can be used as a mold. The Egyptians were experts at making ancient paper from compressed papyrus bulrushes. Of course, over thousands of years, the wooden molds made of papyrus and cotton fibers and palm leaves would never have survived thousands of years. In fact, the wooden molds were probably re-carved into Shabati figurines or just burned as firewood when the Pharaonic dynasties came to an end and Egypt was overrun by Muslims. Based on our own experiments, we conclude that many of the famous sarcophagi which we see at the Louvre in Paris and the British Museum in London were not laboriously carved. They were molded into shape using a two-box technique. And this would explain how the ancient Egyptians managed to make the interior surfaces of the sarcophagus perfectly flat with perfect right-angle inner corners, something which is impossible to do with one of Zahi Hawass's round pounding stones. In fact, Zahi Hawass was featured on television just before the Mubarak regime was toppled. And here we see him opening a newly discovered sarcophagus at Saqqara. And all around him, we can see the walls of the enclosure are covered in ancient concrete render, including the interior of the sarcophagus box itself. It is very obvious that the inner surface has the exact same texture as a molded concrete pot planter. If you would like to join one of our filming crews and go on an expedition to the ancient world, then you need to visit the Enigma Channel website. That's enigmachannel.com, or you can visit the members site at enigmatv.com. Use the contact form and write the word expedition in the subject heading. In exchange for a small contribution towards our filming costs, you will actually become a member of our crew. You'll be eating with us in the same hotels, you'll be traveling with us, you'll be meeting all of the authors and people which we interview. Now, every year, we are filming at amazing museums in places like Athens, Paris, Madrid, Barcelona, New York, Mexico, Egypt, you name it. You'll get to stay in haunted castles. You can visit haunted pubs, you can be taken on moonlit walks around London, and we visit many, many ancient cities. Our expeditions include lectures about things like Nostradamus, the Cathars, the Illuminati, Nikola Tesla, the Vatican, paranormal research. Believe me, it's a lot of fun. So what you do is you contact us via the Enigma Channel websites. It's enigmachannel.com or enigmatv.com. And we look forward to meeting you and look forward to inviting you as a member of our filming crew.
It's not a boat which is meant to be designed to go bloody tourists.
It's now very obvious that many of the large blocks that we see in ancient Egypt were poured into a mold. They were not cut from the bedrock. The base of these molds is made from the previous course of stones, and that is why you cannot stick a pin between these giant blocks of stone. And this is also why the base of these stones are shaped like they were oozing in a liquid form. And this also explains why the base of the sarcophagus inside the king's chamber is not level or flat, when the rest of the surfaces are. It is simply because it was molded into place from a powdered granite. And this also explains why the entrance to the king's chamber did not have to be wider than the width of the sarcophagus, because the sarcophagus was never carried and put in place. It was mixed from a powdered granite and molded into place inside the king's chamber. Many different techniques of stonemasonry were used in constructing the pyramids. Simple earth and water and clay adobe bricks were used, and as we climb up the pyramid, we can see more and more of the smaller blocks are actually made from concrete. These blocks were never cut from the bedrock, nor were they hauled up into place. These blocks were formed in place using a wooden mold box into which the cement mixture was then poured. All over the upper levels of the pyramid exterior, we see evidence of the concrete crumbling, having undergone thousands of years of UV ultraviolet sunlight. Some blocks have a different concrete mix than others, and we can see that wind erosion has caused the binder to erode away, leaving round air holes where the pebbles, which were used as ballast in the concrete mix, have now dropped out and litter every course of stonework on the exterior of the Great Pyramid. Molds were made of many materials such as papyrus paper, rubber, and woven muslin, and even cotton. Egypt's cotton industry is famed for its quality, and cotton production dates back thousands of years. As for ancient rubber, the use of rubber in Africa and also in South America dates back to before the time of the Olmecs. In fact, the word Olmec actually means rubber. And there is plenty of evidence to prove that cocaine and other products such as rubber were traded between the ancient Egyptians and the Olmecs of Central America. Just one example is the mummified body of King Ramesses, whose body tissues contain cocaine and tobacco. Rubber has also been farmed in the Congo since ancient times, and the pharaohs had a global trading empire, which also included the acquisition of eucalyptus oil used in the mummification process, and at the time, the only place where eucalyptus could be obtained is in Australia. Perhaps this explains why the ancient Egyptians also had boomerangs, which you can view to this day in the Cairo Museum. There is a longer, more in-depth version available on the Enigma channel. The Enigma channel is like WikiLeaks, but instead of reading documents about secret subjects, you can put your feet up and watch thousands of fascinating documentary films covering subjects which have been censored and suppressed from the mainstream media for decades. The Enigma channel is a 100% independent TV network, with documentaries and TV shows which are not available on YouTube, not on Netflix, and are unique to the Enigma channel.
Thank you very, very much for watching this episode. And if you head over to the official website, which is forbiddentv.net, you'll be able to download X-rated late-night versions of this show, which investigate voodoo and Jack the Ripper. And you can also visit the Enigma channel and get a subscription and watch literally thousands and thousands of documentaries like this that I've produced over the years. My name is Chris Everard. Thank you for watching. I'll see you in the next episode, and we are going to be visiting Iran, Syria, Tibet, Nepal, India, Spain, France, and Germany in the upcoming episodes. See you then. Thank you.